it is supposed to be all of us, but it's also society. So this is really a model of any functioning society. All functioning societies have these seven domains. And if we're going to function as human beings in whatever society we live in, we need to understand them. We need to interact in them. They have to be meaningful for us. So this rose is also about meaning making. These domains, of course, look very different if we look at a hunter-gatherer society of 50 people or an Iron Age society of 20,000 people or a modern society of millions of people. But every society has production, every society has technology. There may not be science in any scientific way in a hunter-gatherer society. There definitely is, there wasn't even in the Iron Age. But they have factual knowledge that allows them to survive wherever they are. Ethics are the principles that guide us in unfamiliar situations. So the principles behind the narratives, which includes our moral values. That's why I've split them up in that way. I'm going to explain all these domains and their relationship in a second. We have in our narrative, in our cultural heritage, in our mythologies, in our religions, and also in our political ideologies, we have moral values telling us what does it mean to be a good person. And we cannot be human beings without moral values and sharing the narrative about what does it mean to be a good person. So the moral values are the principles or the values that tell us how to behave in familiar situations. That's where we have ritualized our moral values, just within our narratives and our religions and so forth. So ethics is more abstract, and in many societies it's really hard to figure out what are the ethics actually. We spent a couple of hundred years of the Western civilization to get to sort of the bare norms of what's behind our moral values. And we know some of them as our universal human rights. Aesthetics, all societies care about beauty, and we cannot be humans without beauty. So that's music, dance, body ornaments, clothing, but also in a modern context, of course, paintings, modern art, all these expressions. And then we have power, and all societies have some sort of power. In a tribal society, it can be the wise elders, it can be the strongest guy with the biggest club, or it can be, in a modern democratic society, of course, the institutions of power that we have. And in order to thrive in our society, we need to understand all these seven domains. Production is the physical item for the food and shelter, but also the supporting production, by which I mean the banks and where we get our money from. I could make a digression regarding what is money, not going to be here. Technology can be anything from a stone axe to an autonomous killer drone with artificial intelligence. So it's a wide span, it depends on what culture we're looking at. As societies grow and become more complex, so do each of these domains. And they become subsystems of their own, with their own institutions, their own norms, their own rules, their own procedures. And they separate. That's the cultural evolution that we've seen since the tribal societies, that they've specialized and they have diversified, and they've done that in a process where they, in some instances, really hated each other. I mean, science separated itself from narrative, from religion, almost violently. Actually, it's religion that treated the scientists violently, but it was a real struggle to separate these two domains from each other. There are conflicts between them, particularly the domains that are opposite each other. So they tend to really try to get away from each other, and they can really live each other, or the people in those domains simply cannot understand how the other people are thinking in the other domains. But there are opposite from one another, a really strong conflict. over can be problematic. They communicate in different ways, they have different values, they think in different ways. On the other hand, they also share something with their neighbor, because science and production produce new technologies. The knowledge from science and the means of production create new technologies. Science and religion share ethics. They're not the same ethics, but science wouldn't be science if it didn't have some universal principles behind it. It's a process, it's a procedure. And that is also what is its value. It's abstract principles that are expressed through ritual and tradition that are our moral values. So there's also something that science and religion share, science and narrative. Production and narrative also share their use of aesthetics. That's why we have commercials in production. And religion wouldn't work if it didn't explore beauty in order to elevate our spirit, in order to transcend ourselves and connect to the divine, or whatever we prefer to call it. So there, I mean, there's a complex dynamic between those different domains. It is, however, important that all of them want to be part of the same society and collaborate around this society, because if they don't, production can become exploitation, it can become cynicism. That's when we have slavery and abuse of various kinds, also of nature. Technology can disrupt society. It disrupts the means of production, ownership, and economic power in society. Science can become arrogance. Of course, there's nobody here who write their scientific papers so that only their colleagues in the same sciences can understand what they're saying, but such scientists are out there, and the rest of society have no clue what they're talking about. And that's the kind of arrogance that's really dangerous for all of us. Ethics that are too abstract and advanced or complex for people to understand can cause anxiety, because it looks as if there are no moral values at all, if it's too distant from the moral values that people already know. The narratives are what allow us to have emotional and social cohesion in our societies at the symbolic level, but it can also, if it does not play along with the rest of society, and particularly the economic and scientific and technological development, become narrow-mindedness and insist on there only being one truth, and that would be typically one religion. When I'm less politically correct, I would, instead of narrow-mindedness, write stupidity. So the narrative can be really narrow-minded. Aesthetics can cause confusion and anxiety, like ethics, if art becomes too abstract and too advanced for people to understand. Those appeared in German history, where it was called an Abendkunst. It's beyond what people can grasp, and so it causes anxiety. And if any of these domains drift apart from the rest of society, the power in the center becomes, or has to become, more controlling or abusive in order to keep society together, unless all the other domains are granted the same freedom for development and expanding their complexity as well, says this model. Whenever we are working in one of these domains, we can also choose to collaborate with that which is most distant from our own domain, and thus sort of try to bridge the gap and bring society together. And if production has ethics, it can become sustainable prosperity. If narrative, be it religion or historians or political ideology, accept that technological development can bring us forward, but it will also change structures in society, we can create meaningful and purposeful development, particularly if people in the technological development pay attention to the narratives and moral values that keep society together, and make sure that they don't disrupt it unless they collaborate with the rest of society. And then if we have the arts, the aesthetics, and science working together, we can create deep education and understanding that touches us emotionally, so that we're open to the science that we need to understand in order to navigate the world as it is. So in order to have a thriving society, these several domains need to be in balance. And if we are going to live a meaningful life in our society, we need to understand some of all of them, which means that we need to have appropriate education, which is a challenge, because as complex as our societies have become, that demands a lot of education. We'll just come to learn throughout life, but it also means that we're challenged in grasping what's going on. And one of the really big challenges here is that production and technology get all the investments. Not all of them. I mean, there's investment in the rest. But there's an imbalance. And not only is there a higher return on investment in the simplest sense, if you invest in production and technology, it is also the two domains that produce the money and expand the money mass. So I put the banks in the production side of this model. That is where the debt is created that expands the money mass. But now the technologies are creating cryptocurrencies, which means that we're expanding the money mass even further by just creating a whole new kind of money. And you were talking about the real economy and the not so real economy. I mean, this totally brings society out of balance and where we have the power. And the problem is that our meaning making, which is really down in the other five domains, is not keeping up with the technological development and the production. And I would say one of the obvious ways that our meaning making has not kept up with production is the belief, that really is belief, that it's optimal for us as a species to catch fish in the around Greenland, shipping it to China in order to be filleted and fried and packaged and frozen, and then shipped back to the Nordic countries for consumption. That makes economic sense in a very narrow sense, but it does not make sense in a broader sense. So if we don't get the full picture, we cannot grasp what is actually going on, which means that we have an imbalance. And that means that power can or must become controlling and abusive if we are to contain this development, unless the rest of society follows suit and we have the education and the collaboration across the aisle or across the bridge here, so that people in production and technology find meaning and purpose in collaborating with the rest of society and keeping the balance. This picture could be either Western economy where technological development is running amok. It could also be China as it already is. And of course, if it's religion that defines everything, you get all the, if it's only religion that is allowed to become more and more complex and expand its complexity, then society becomes more and more controlling over the rest of the domains, because then you're not allowed to discuss the fundamental ethics, you can't develop your aesthetics, science is not functioning, and of course the technological development of production is stalling, call it Saudi Arabia, Iran, or whatever you want to call it, but it would be the same issue. So, the Rose Garden economy has nice little happy roses where everything is more or less in balance, and we should all have enough knowledge to understand all of the domains and be a thriving rose. Our individuals, our cities, our local communities, our countries, continents, and the globe as a whole should be rose gardens with thriving roses and with happy gardeners.